tracking the highs.
And around the Sacramento area, about 102.
And lows.
We'll be a chilly start. Look at these overnight lows. We'll be down in the 30s.
Ups.
A year's worth of work comes down to this day.
And downs.
The question we've been getting asked for months is, are we in a drought?
Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan has been your trusted source.
This is why more people need to watch Mark Finan.
Why is that?
They know not to come up here on a day like this.
For 33 years at Channel 3.
It is a record this morning in Modesto. We've assembled the weather team here to talk about just how dry it has been.
Tonight, some of the biggest weather events of his career.
This is the storm we're looking at.
This is the third time we've had an El Nino this strong.
See how those flames are leaping up into the air?
The level of the lake kept going up.
It's all about the weather.
In a KCRA3 special, Mark Finan's memorable moments.
And thank you for joining us for our KCRA3 News Special, celebrating our chief meteorologist, Mark Finan, and his retirement. For 33 years now, Mark has been the weather expert our viewers turn to for forecasts, storm coverage, wildfire evacuations, and a whole lot more. Tonight, we're walking you through some of the biggest, most impactful weather events of his career and giving you some insight into how Mark covered them. And Mark, I mean, the technology has really evolved over the time you've been here.
Over the 33 years, it's amazing to see what we started with the 90s and what we have now. We'll start with 1997, where serious flooding affected almost every community in our area.
It was New Year's Day, 1997, and the rain just wouldn't stop.
The National Weather Service once again calling for devastating flooding.
A huge Pineapple Express storm was soaking Northern California.
This is a special report.
And what you're seeing on your television is exactly why we are not broadcasting Days of Our Lives. This is a very bad thing that's going on throughout our region right now.
On the 25th anniversary of the storm back in 2021, we talked to former Livecopter 3 pilot Michael Kidd, who worked with Mark to inform viewers of each development during those intense days of flooding.
Check with Michael Kidd, who's been flying around checking water levels for us. Michael, what's the latest with you?
It was amazing that it's like, oh, look here, and I'm getting a call, go look here, and it's like, this is everywhere. It was so widespread, and then you know, some places worse than others.
In the first 2 days of the flood, the views from Livecopter showed levees crumbling on the Cosumnes River.
This is maybe one of our first actual breaks, Sam, and this is upstream from Wilton, and it's on the north side of the Cosumnes River this time. And this is an area where we were watching people sandbag and sandbag. In fact, they had a bulldozer that still remains, and the river got the best of them.
The National Guard made an air rescue on Twin Cities Road.
This is again some flooding that's taking place with the Cosumnes River, and below that National Guard helicopter, someone trapped on top of their pickup truck.
And the American River was running near the tops of the levees.
Here's the white spot. That's River Park on the left side of your screen. And the Cal Expo area, well off, actually out of frame there on the right side. But the river, extremely wide. In fact, even at this distance, can't fit it all into the camera here. Very wide through this point.
But it was the morning of January 3rd that was the most devastating.
It's not a pretty sight. Take a look for yourself. A very wide break here in the levee along the Feather River.
You don't want to wake, you know, you're going to wake up and see that today. It's like, wow, this is my neighborhood.
They just pulled a person out of there, but look where they are working over. Whoever was trapped there, I mean, there's not even a tree to cling to down there. They're in just brush.
Well, January 3rd saw the most destruction. It also brought one bright spot to flood-weary Californians.
We saw him sitting there forlornly just out on the rooftop.
A dog was stuck on the roof of one of the homes that was flooded in Arboga, and he was surrounded by rising flood water. We came to learn that the name of the dog was Rodeo, and as it was about to get dark, Michael and our photographer decided to make a rescue.
The dog just sitting there, the water's going up, you know, the dog's, you know, doesn't have much longer, and you know what the right thing to do is.
How dangerous was that to be landing a skid on a house, or balancing a skid on a house?
Well, depends on the pilot.
Our team rescued Rodeo from the roof, and he was reunited with his family that evening.
All these losses, and then that was a win.
How are you doing?
Yeah, it felt really good.
Everybody was cheering that rescue for sure. One of the things that really stands out is how difficult a disaster like that is to map, to understand the scope of it when the landmarks are underwater, and you didn't even know until first light when we could get live copter 3 up what it looked like.
And those are the pictures I remember most. You know, we had that 80 some odd hours of coverage, but it was that morning that I remember the most, and all we could see is water and rooftops, and there was very little sticking out of the water. Mm-hmm. But you knew that there were people that had been evacuated in the middle of the night, that they wanted to know if their house was underwater, if their neighborhood was
underwater. Precise information.
And so what we did was, using Michael in the helicopter, he could find railroads that were out of the water, overpasses. And we had primitive mapping on our radar system at that time, because this is before Google Earth was available.
Right.
So what we did was we just kind of would go through, all right, west of here, it's okay, but to the east of there, it's underwater, that sort of thing. And so we're able to piece it together more or less road by road, using the primitive technology we had, considering what we have now, to map it out and let people know what was underwater. And it was something that you just kind of put yourself in the position of the people that were not in their homes to try to give them any information we could.
What do they need to know? You know, yeah. Compare that to exactly 26 years later after that flooding in 97. Storms again walloped Northern California once again. It fell right on New Year's Day. Mark headed out for live reports along Highway 99 so that people could see the flooding.
I am on Highway 99, which is currently closed if you're trying to come southbound at Grantline Road, but we are here and there are a number of rescue vehicles here. So this is Dillard Road. This is Highway 99. As you can clearly see, the road is covered in water. Now, just within the last 5 minutes, off to the east, we saw a helicopter that we just learned took two people out. They were stranded on Dillard Road.
Later that day, Mark was up in Live Copter 3 showing our viewers some of the damage from above. Three people were found dead following this flooding. Cleanup and repairs from the storm took months. In fact, hundreds of power poles were damaged or destroyed. But by this time, you were able to forecast flooding with such better precision.
And it's directly tied to 1997. Even though we didn't have as much water this time as we did in 97, what we learned was what that water coming down the Cosumnes would do. We knew that 24 hours in advance this time, that Dillard Road, Twin Cities Road, and Highway 99 would be underwater. So we knew that 24 hours ahead of time, and it's just amazing to see the changes we learned. From 97, we wouldn't have known that as much as we did last year.
That when a river level hits a certain point, you know the impact downstream.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, of course, another important part of Mark's coverage has been covering wildfires, especially as they're becoming larger and more destructive here in California. Over the past few years, as a team, we've learned a lot more about fire behavior and what our viewers need to know when every second matters.
Fires have become more destructive.
We're in Indian Falls right now, where the Dixie Fire has destroyed some homes, and you can see some of that damage.
And they have become deadlier in Northern California.
For those familiar with the town of Paradise, this right here is the Safeway.
Over the years, our understanding of fire behavior has also grown.
Very active on the southern end of the fire.
That knowledge was crucial during the Caldor fire in August of 2021.
Look at the massive plumes of smoke. Fire officials just say this is incredible fire activity that they haven't seen before.
The fire tore through parts of the Sierra, leading to thousands of evacuations in the Tahoe Basin.
It's scary. It's very scary. You wonder if you have your home.
During the fire's first days, every moment mattered for residents and first responders.
Our main focus is life safety. We've got a lot of our occupants out of the Tahoe Basin. Life safety for our crews is critical right now.
We usually use radar to show you rain, but what we're looking at here are smoke plumes. So look at this area of yellow down in here. That's where the fire is hottest.
From our weather center, we monitored explosive fire behavior leading to rapid spread.
This is the pieces of the tree that are basically still on fire, and they're being carried up into the atmosphere a couple of thousand feet, and they can't cool off in time. By the time they land, they can start a fire downwind.
The fire leveled the community of Grizzly Flats and destroyed more than 1,000 buildings.
Can't do anything about it. It's nature. I just wish we didn't lose everything. I mean, we lost everything.
That's scary. So it's forever in my heart.
And of course, fires are, you know, another example of a disaster where precise mapping is so important. Now you do have tools like Google Earth.
You know, and I think about some of the fires that we've had over the last 30 years. And back in the 90s, I remember there were some bigger fires and we just couldn't tell the complete story.
Right.
Because we didn't have good mapping. We didn't have a lot of information from some of these relatively rural areas. Well, now we do with better mapping. Now we have an extensive camera network we can tap into, and there are a lot more weather sensors out there too. So we know better what the wind is doing, we know better about the fire behavior, and it helps not only me, but all of our team tell the viewer a better story of what's going on, where the fire is, where it's going, where it might be going, that sort of thing. And it's just amazing just how much more technology has helped us over the last 30 years. 30 years ago, we couldn't do what we could now. And it all has to do with technology. And it's so important, Edie, because we have so many more people that live in more of these rural areas than we did 30 years ago. So when we do get a big fire, there are just so many more people that could be in harm's way. And those people need the information that we're now getting available to us.
Yeah, as quickly and precisely as possible.
Exactly, yep.
Well, still ahead, a spillway crisis like nothing we had ever seen. The disaster that left a gaping hole in the Oroville spillway, plus about 200,000 people evacuated. We'll look back on those tense moments and what's happened since then. Welcome back to our KCRA3 special, Mark Finan's Memorable Moments. We're looking back on more than three decades of Mark's career and his impressive coverage as he's getting ready now for retirement.
And one event that really stands out is the Oroville spillway incident in 2017, when there were concerns about a total failure of the emergency spillway that led to the evacuation of tens of thousands of people near the Oroville area.
This is not normal.
Whoa, see, a piece of cement just flew off.
It started in early February of 2017. First, tiny chunks of concrete, then a bigger hole, and the damage became more dramatic.
There's where the hole was, and as you can see, the water just channeled itself down, took out the whole hillside there.
Livecopter 3 pilot Dave Allen was over the Oroville spillway with Mark closely monitoring from the Weather Center.
Dirk and I kind of did some quick math, and it's probably about another hour and a half to 2 hours that the lake will drop below the level of the auxiliary or the emergency spillways. It may not have been designed to have water come off of that, because as we've been documenting, the emergency spillway has never been used. The lake has never been this high.
A near failure at the spillway led to nearly 200,000 evacuations.
They're worried about it. They don't think it's going to hold up.
We had an hour evacuation notice. Everybody was panicking.
For those downstream, every update was
like
vital.
And this is going to be the worst case scenario I'll point out right now. If let's say there is a hole or an area that's been eroded on this side of the auxiliary spillway, it might act like a boil in a levee.
It's very much a fluid and dynamic operation that is going on out there.
Crews worked against time on repairs, preventing a total failure.
There are a lot of people that live in eyesight of here, in Oroville and Live Oak and even toward Marysville, Yuba City, that still have a lot of anxiety.
It took months for engineers and crews to reconstruct the spillway, ensuring the safety of communities downstream.
And in all of these emergencies, we are always so aware of our role in providing good communication. In this case, 180,000 people being evacuated, so making sure they got out safely. But also, there were a lot of concerns at that time about what was going to happen to their homes and property.
I remember that Sunday afternoon quite vividly, and there was a lot of misinformation. There were rumors around that the dam itself was going to fail.
The entire thing,
not just the emergency spillway, which of course is a much, much different thing. So our role that afternoon was to give information to people, the correct information, mm-hmm. as well as to help alleviate some concerns. Because every hour that went by that the lake level did come down, the threat level started to come down. And it was important to not only tell people, yes, this is an emergency, but it may not be as bad as an emergency as you think it is, and hour by hour, it's getting better. So it was that sort of needle you're trying to thread about making sure people are aware, but it's not as bad as some of the rumors are letting you know.
Well, next, we're going to have some fun, enjoying a glass of wine and everything that's gone into it. Coming up, we'll show you the Wine and Weather series that Mark produced and what we learned about wine season here in Northern California. Welcome back to our KCRA 3 special, Mark Finan's Memorable Moments. Back in 2007, Mark was out of our weather center and into wine country, combining two of his favorite things for a series called Wine and Weather.
You know, wine in California is a multi-billion dollar industry, and nothing affects the grapes more than the weather. So we headed out to the Boger Winery over the course of the year to follow the growing season.
California's wine industry contributes billions of dollars to the state's economy, and much of its success hinges on the weather.
Welcome to KCRA 3 Wine and Weather with Weather Plus Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan.
We closely track the growing season of 2007, talking to winemakers about the challenges they faced over the year and how weather played a role.
The last time we were here, we were talking about frost damage and what it meant to the primary clusters. Now that we're past frost season, it's easy to see the difference between the primary clusters, which are much larger, and these much smaller secondary clusters, which don't have the same quality as the primary. So we're past frost season and we're looking good.
Winemakers showed us why cold weather can be good for the vines and how workers pruned thousands of vines on the property by hand.
The vines all ready to pick. We've checked the sugar.
Come September, it was time for harvesting, and the end of growing season meant the beginning of winemaking.
The must is pumped into a tank. I'll take a sample to run the chemical analysis on it, see what the sugars are, the acids, then I'll inoculate it with yeast.
They told us it was an ideal year, and this Zinfandel was one to remember.
At first glance, the color is vibrant. I'm most impressed by the brilliant color and the depth of color.
It's even better than I thought it was from when I looked at the fruit coming in.
Have a good night. Cheers.
Well, of course, agriculture just in general is so important to this region. And Mark, I know farmers are going to miss you because, weather's important.
Every season it changes. What's important to cherry farmers might be different from what's important to rice farmers. Yeah. I hear from them all the time, but that's always a concern for us as we go through every season because we know the ag industry is so important. And you wonder every year just... every season, just what is important going on right now, especially if you get rain in the springtime, it can affect so many crops. It's good for some and it's bad for others. It's always so important here in Northern California.
At least with accurate forecasting, they can plan around it and sometimes protect their crops.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, what's next for Mark? Let's show you. This assignment gives you kind of a clue. Next, we will launch into one of his favorite days at work and what he sees from the other side of the camera. Welcome back to our KCRA 3 special, looking back on Mark Finan's most memorable moments as he's getting ready to retire. You know, one aspect of your work that I have always really loved is how much you enjoy and really appreciate Northern California's beauty.
I do, and I like being out in it more than just being in the office. But one of my favorite assignments was in April of last year, I got to fly over Yosemite in Live Copter 3 to cover the potential for flooding.
Yosemite Valley, known for its waterfalls, and they are flowing and they are spectacular. You're looking at Bridal Veil Falls, one of the number of waterfalls that are flowing down into the valley. And of course, all of those waterfalls eventually drain into the Merced River, which makes up the central part of the Yosemite Valley. And it is the issue with the Merced River that is causing a partial closure of the valley this weekend. We are going to continue to see the snow melt, increase the level on the Merced River. It'll go up another couple of feet between now and Sunday, and already, even with the level of the river where it is right now, you're starting to see the river kind of spread out into some of the meadows that are upstream of El Capitan, up toward the Ahwahnee and toward the chapel, and just downstream from where Yosemite Falls itself is what you're seeing here. So with those areas getting underwater and maybe getting some water up onto the roadways, that's why this part of the park is going to be closed this weekend.
And Mark has seen Yosemite during every season over the years. It's usually from the ground as he takes beautiful photos like these. We know you'll be heading up to Yosemite much more often. That means more time to relax, continue your artistic work on the other side of the camera, and appreciate the beauty of Northern California. So you've also served as a mentor. We know that you leave us in good hands with our weather team, but we will really miss you as a leader in our newsroom and as a friend.
I'll miss the KCRA family, but I do know that, as you mentioned, the weather team is in great shape.
Yeah.
We have a great news team and a great weather team working together. But I also want to take time to thank the viewers, because I think so often when we have stories like we were just covering tonight, that it's the viewers that helped us tell the story by giving us information. So I want to thank the viewers for helping me out over the last 30 years as well.
All right, Mark, we wish you all the best in your retirement.
Thank you.